Welcome to the Selectmen's meeting for the 4th of March, 2013. First order is, please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to take up the acceptance corrections of the minutes for the 25th of February. And that will, should include two sessions of non-public.
I'll make a motion to approve. With corrections. You have a few?
Yeah.
A lot.
I'll second.
Thank you, Merrick. Okay, Scott, you may start off.
Sue, you may start off.
Or Sue.
I'm going to leave out punctuation, you know. I'm just going to do the substantive changes, okay? Page 9 in the motion, it should be SAU number 19. The U is missing. Under same page, amendment to the Compass Smart Shopper Program, the last sentence should say, no, it's only been in effect for 1 month. We will wait for a quarterly report. Vehicle use policy, I've talked to Catherine about these. I've asked her to take out in the first sentence, I attended, because it wasn't me that attended that one. It was Derek. And then the last sentence before the motion, it wasn't on page 6. It was the number 6 that was amended on that same page 2. Then on page 10, fourth sentence, I would just delete that. That's kind of an incomplete sentence.
Sentence that starts with what?
Sue said about conservation's land on the mountain. I would delete that. Sentence, Sue said it wouldn't hurt to have an update, not updated. Legislative update, first sentence needs to be restructured. Sue said when updates are provided, if any of you would like to discuss one or any with the full board, let me know. Let's see. Mm-hmm. The other one was in that same one. Sue explained what it is. Sue explained it was title loans on vehicles, I believe is what I said. Page 11. First full paragraph, Sue said they did say the current setup, the accessibility in administration, town clerk, and tax collector's office is too open. That's all I had.
Where was that last one?
It was
word easy.
Last sentence.
All stricken by the word open. You found yours?
No.
Oh, you knew.
I did that.
I whispered to him.
Yeah.
Any further corrections necessary? Call for the vote. Those in favor of the amended minutes, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passes. And we'll move into announcements. And let me do... See, the first one is road restrictions. And effective last week, Public Works announced load and weight restrictions on town roads. There's I know the announcement said 12 tons, Carl, but there's various weight limits for, depending on the size of the truck, and the images of all those vehicle sizes are on the signs. Black on orange signs have been posted on all the side roads leading off our main corridors. Thank you for posting those. And you anticipate those signs being up for?
It'll be at least a month.
At least a month.
Yeah. If Puxatawney Phil is correct, it should be much more than that.
I don't think he was right.
Is he ever?
It's a bad reputation.
It's a poor record, actually.
Yeah, he has a very poor record.
Yeah.
Okay. How do we know that they were ready for the second announcement?
I told them we would call them at 6:05, so we're right on schedule. Careful you don't trip on any of these cords here.
This is a technological first for us?
We've done interviews.
Okay. The individual in Florida is going to be, I believe, projected up on the screen, but you two are okay. You want this light off over here?
I think I'm going to slide around the corner.
The Donald Trump that's coming on?
No, it's Oracle of Omaha.
Do you want me to put this light off too?
No, that's good.
Good evening.
Good evening. Can you see us?
Yes, I can. I can see Mr. Pierce. Okay. Right in the middle of the screen.
Yeah, unfortunately.
You're tuned into the right channel then.
Unfortunately, we can't see you. Hold on. There we go.
There we go. Okay. Good evening.
Good evening.
From sunny Florida.
It's snowing up here.
Yeah, right.
And Sonny, I assume there's somebody else with you in that room?
Well, there is somebody that is in the building with me. I will go get her.
You please do that. And
hey, wait a second. Somebody wants to talk to you.
You didn't register to vote, right? You have a problem with your voting registration.
Well, David, you should have something better to do than talk to me.
Well, I wish I was there for the sunny weather and.
Can't beat it with a stick. It's great.
Susan, if you would just sort of raise your head about 4 inches, that's wonderful. Thank you.
Military stance, right? Set up straight.
You've been well trained in all those board meetings. I'm very happy to be able to announce to the residents of the town this evening that Susan Tremblay has been, the town report is dedicated in your honor. And this is the 2012 town report. And on the inside cover is a picture of you, and all the selectmen have signed in our gold pen. So upon your return, and unless this is, this will be presented to you back to Gulfstown. And I have a short paragraph here or two to read, which is part of the dedication. Susan Tremblay has been an active, dedicated volunteer for the town of Gulfstown and the Gulfstown School District for the past 28 years. She has served on the school board for 18 years. Demonstrating her leadership quality as vice chair for 3 and chair for 4 years. She served on many school board committees, including the building committees, the administration and finance committees, the negotiations committee, and the area review committee. She was also school board representative for the TB, Gulfstown TB, capital improvements committee, and the budget committee. On the town side, Susan served as an elected budget committee member for 9 years. Cable committee member for 2 years and capital improvements committee for 3 years. Supervisor of the checklist for 5 years. You were chair of that committee, of that checklist for 1. And for too many years than we care to count, you were also a poll worker.
Yes.
Are you going to be, by the way, are you going to be here for the 12th of March?
No, sorry.
Okay. The dedication goes on to say, in the community, she has been active participant in the Bartlett Community Club that was once called the Bartlett's Mother's Club for over 20 years and is president for about 7 years. She was involved in their pancake breakfast, Easter egg hunts, and even chaired the penny sale. She served as the secretary of the Goffstown Junior Baseball for 7 years and is a team mother of that little league. If this wasn't enough, she was also a Girl Scout leader for 7 years and a teacher at the St. Edmund's Church for 4 years. Susan's been married to Adrian Sonny for 46 years. Hello, Adrian. They've lived in Goffstown for 42 of those years. They have four children. Their names are Catherine, Cynthia, John, and Andrew. All four children were educated in our school systems. Their first grandchild, a girl, is expected on the 1st of March. Well,
She came in. She's here. Yay. Audrey Rose is here.
First grandchild. Congratulations. Yes.
Congratulations.
Your countless volunteer hours illustrate your passion to improve and increase the opportunity of the children in our town. We thank you, Susan, for all that you do for the children of Goffstown. In recognition of your volunteerism for the school board, the Selectmen is honored to dedicate the 2012 annual report to you. Congratulations.
This makes me feel tired. But well, I will say I've enjoyed every minute of it, and when folks ask me why I do it, it's because you meet the nicest people.
And for
these things.
And I know you're used to being on TV, Goffstown TV. This time you're live. I know the school board isn't always live on Monday evenings,
right,
but right now, on courtesy of through the Skype connection, you're live.
Terrific.
Bring back some warm weather back to Goffstown.
I hope to. We will see you all at the beginning of April.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
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 Congratulations. Thanks, Sonny.
Thank you, Sue.
Okay.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Bye now.
Bye.
That was neat. A first board meeting, New Hampshire to Florida. Well, now we have a public comment session. This is an opportunity for members of the town to provide public comment to the board. 3 minutes on subjects that aren't part of the formal agenda. I understand we have somebody here this evening. If you like to come up to the seat and so the microphone can pick up your comments better. Please identify yourself and what do you wish to tell us?
First of all, thank you for having us here tonight. My name is Frank Spagna, my wife Susan, and we live at 74 Fairview Street in Pinardville, and we currently have a sewer line issue in front of our house. It's been ongoing for a week today, and I've been talking to several people that are here tonight on the issue, and it's become a health issue right now. We've been without sewer for a week, and because of the paving moratorium and everything that's in effect right now, it's a hardship for us to incur the expenses.
We're just trying to understand.
Just to understand,
the cost of all this here
is beyond anything that we could ever expect. And basically, that's the issue right now. We do have an emergency in effect, from what I understand. I've been talking to Carl and to Collis this week. They've been very helpful, and they're going to start the digging part of the operation actually tomorrow, and hopefully it'll be resolved in the next couple of days. But I guess the real issue with us is the moratorium on the paving on the street and the astronomical cost that's involved with this moratorium. And we'd just like to see if we can get some sort of help and
understanding
of this, the
whole
thing.
And if it's ever been incurred by somebody else in the past, whatever this is, moratorium 7 years or whatever it is, and if anyone has had to really do this and pay the whole cost on something like this. I understand there was abuses in the past, and that's why these moratorium, self-imposed moratoriums come up. And we've heard all the stories about people who abuse the system, but we feel as though, you know, being Ghost Town residents over 40 years, this is, you know, it's a tough one to swallow. Well, it really is.
Yes, I'm sorry for the inconvenience you've been experiencing.
Second time.
Yes.
We've been through this in October already, too.
Is there, and you've been in contact with the Public Works and the sewer?
Yes.
Technician part of that Public Works group. Yes. And Collis, do you have anything you want to add?
Well, no, I've had discussions with them over the weekend. Certainly they're in a tough situation. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to find a way to provide relief, not only to them, but to those who may come in the future, a way to address this. This is a serious concern. This is a health issue. And I don't think the ordinance was intended to put people in this position. And I think it's something we need to correct, and we're going to take that up later on in the agenda.
The moratorium you spoke of, that's not the weight restriction. This is because the road was recently paved. Yes.
And if I can just ask a question, the cost you're talking about, obviously there's construction costs involved to repair the situation. Are those, I don't think those are the costs you're talking about, or are they? I think there's an issue with the bonding, if I understand it correctly, that's of concern.
No, I think our issue was we had this repaired in October. I don't know if you know any of the background on it. We had this problem in October. We had someone come in and replace it from the house to the street. And at the time, Mike Walton had told us, I hope it's not in the street because there's a moratorium. Well, as he got closer to the street, the break was right before the street. Everything's paved, it's fine. And we were told about this moratorium, but of course we put it out of our mind because the break was before the street. Now we're into this again. And I think we just needed some more understanding of, you know, what's going to be involved. And as we've gone through the estimates on trying to get this repaired, I mean, we have no problem. We're looking at a section of maybe, you know, maybe the section that connects to the sewer or whatever's under the street. You know, we don't even know where this break is. We don't know if it's Goffstown's break or the connection from when the street was widened and paved or our break. I just think that we just...
There's a gray area to put up that much money, not knowing exactly what's
But
what's
from
there.
The estimates that we've been told, the paving is the biggest issue, this 50 feet on other side. And then we've got three driveways to be involved, which is cost with the paving person, the person that's John Neville, that's supposed to do it. There's certain ways it has to be tied into driveways. We're looking at three driveways that have to be tied in, as well as this 100-foot of road. I mean, it's just, to me, it's an excess. I mean, we're looking still at a good $6,000 to have the plumbing part of it done, but a $9,000 cost for paving is kind of, you know, above and beyond. So it is a hardship. It really is.
Any further comments on the board?
I had a question. Do we know where the break is, and is it a situation where the sewer commission, it's actually their pipe, and if that is the case, or we don't know that? Because if it is their pipe, am I assuming incorrectly that it would be the sewer commission's responsibility to repair the pipe and any resultant pavement?
See, this is what we don't know. Initially, the first day that it happened, we had a plumber come in and route the line out for us, and he hit a hard blockage.
And he left it there.
And he left it there. We couldn't get through it. So we put a camera into it.
Gotcha.
And about three quarters of the way down the new line, we couldn't see anything because of the water in the line. The camera just went black.
Right.
We couldn't distinguish it. But 99.9%, in the street. It's because everything is brand new from October, this past October, to the street. It's been repaired.
And he left it in there and went out with a...
They have a meter that
A meter that you can go in the road with. So we were out there Monday night, and he pinpointed is approximately... He can't say exactly where it is, but the meter was beeping out there, and he marked it with a red line.
Approximately about 3 feet into the street.
Would the board like Public Works to provide us a summary of what they're discovering tomorrow? And just as a report.
I know for the citizens here, I just want to make it clear that there's a sewer commission, mm-hmm. there's a board of selectmen. The reason why DPW is involved is because DPW does work for the sewer commission, and then there's a reimbursement, you know, part of that. In terms of authority, you know, we as a board sometimes, we're not going to have the authority to say we are responsible for that. That's the sewer commission.
But we can communicate.
We can certainly do that through DPW to say, hey, let's get out there and let's see what's going on. Yeah, I mean, this is a health issue.
Yes, it is. Which is why I'm involved as the selectman's rep
right.
to the sewer commission
right.
to try and help move this process forward. But I, you're right. We need to do a little bit more research to make sure we put the pieces together to find out mm-hmm. exactly where the blockage is. It's my understanding it's somewhere in the connection line, the service line from the house to the sewer, but beyond the property limits, somewhere in there. We're not sure. We have to do a little bit more research. It's my understanding that the DPW is prepared to work with them, and I would expect perhaps we can even hear some.
Do we have any official word from the sewer commission? Have they been talked about? Have they been spoken to about this? I'm assuming.
I've had conversations with Ellen Noyes, the secretary.
Right.
Again, it's her opinion that you know we ought to work cooperatively. They're good customers. They've been longtime customers. You know, we ought to provide them whatever assistance we can. And I think we should do that. And I think we'll take the steps to do that tonight, I would hope.
I'd be willing to entertain an authorization for this, for the chair to express a desire from this board for the sewer commission to promptly do what's necessary, whether it's contracting with Public Works or contracting with somebody else.
The street opening, or the excavation, what's it called, your excavation ordinance? Or is the Board of Selectmen's, and that's...
Before we get too far aside, I'll just kind of tell the board what we know.
What we are 99.9% sure of is the blockages in the service line. Whenever we have a problem like this, our staff goes out and opens the manholes above and below to make sure the main line is flowing. That is the case on Fairview Street. The sewer commission's responsibility is the main line. Any house service branching off is the responsibility of the homeowner. That even though it's in the street, it's their responsibility from the main to the house. So we're 99.9% sure that the blockage is somewhere in that service line under the street. If when we get digging, we find that somehow the problem was caused by the sewer commission, historically, I've never known the sewer commission to turn a blind eye to their responsibility. The same would be said of the town. If for some reason we discovered that, you know, excavating a drain line or whatever during construction, it was damaged, obviously the town would take care of that. But by all indication, it's just an old service line that needs to be repaired. The big issue is the moratorium, as they've said, what we'll talk about later is, unfortunately, when that ordinance was written back in 1998, we didn't even leave ourselves an option to discuss a hardship. I don't have any option. The board doesn't have any option. So it's kind of it's a bad ordinance. It's been around a long time, but this is the first time we've ever kind of experienced this real hardship issue where any one of us would hear the hardship in a minute and say, oh, this isn't reasonable and we need to fix it. Unfortunately, we legally didn't leave ourselves that wiggle room, so I think we have to go through an ordinance amendment just so that the board can consider some kind of waiver to the requirement.
And of course, we don't want to hold up the work. Their needs are immediate, and the legal process to change an ordinance is a 6 to 7 week process.
But it's a two-step process. One is the emergency repair, and there's an ability to do that.
Right.
You can authorize the emergency repair to make them whole, get their service connection up and running and functioning.
Correct.
The other issue is, what do we do about repaving the street and repairing the town infrastructure?
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're going to talk about that.
Right.
And in the meantime, at least they'll be whole.
Right.
And we'll deal with how we repair the street and bring it back to town standards through an ordinance change and dealing with this in the process.
Well, Frank, Susan, sorry for the condition, but thank you for bringing it to our attention so we can pay more attention ourselves with what the Public Works and is doing in behalf of the Sewer Commission.
Well, that's all we ask.
That's all we ask.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks for coming.
Slightly more than 3 minutes, but you're
okay. Okay, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you for coming in.
On the next item on our agenda is a meeting with Carol Quarum, our Public Works Director, on five different subjects. First one deals with Phelpstown Village Water Precinct and work that you're anticipating to do on Pleasant Street.
Yes, and
otherwise known as Route 13, coming from Maine, going towards New Boston.
Yes, and Al Gammons, if you want to come up, Al, the chair of the Village Water Precinct.
Please, Al, come forward to the microphone.
Able to join me for this discussion? This is a revisit of an issue that we discussed a little over a month ago or so, and I know the board had a few concerns in that there was no date for repayment spelled out, and there were possibly a couple of things missing from the cost estimate. So Lee Minnick and I did get together and kind of rework that. We're still of the opinion that this is the best way to get this repair done on for both the town and for the water precinct. So we are interested in moving forward. What I believe we're talking about is, you know, as part of our reconstruction efforts, while we have the road kind of milled and torn up, we could get the water precinct pipe installed with our in-house forces at the same time. Obviously, the precinct has all the materials. We're not in the water business. Their folks would be working with our folks because they're the ones that know how to install the pipes and make sure they're installed properly. All we're really doing is providing the machine and the equipment to do the digging. And those costs would be reimbursed the town in the spring of 2014. And what this allows for the water precinct is to get this done all in one season rather than, as they've done jobs in the past, kind of breaking it up over several years to get it done.
Comments by the board?
Well, for clarification, the second whereas, Carl, it's 2,000 linear feet, I assume?
Yes.
We're talking about there, so it needs to be an addition.
Some of that water pipe has been in the ground for a long time. There used to be a valley in the road, and the water pipe in front of my property on Pleasant Street is down a little over 8 feet because of the backfilling that was done there.
So, Mr. Gammons, all the trenching and replacement of the water line will be done this coming summer.
Yes.
And then at some point after that, Public Works will provide the water precinct an invoice. You have some rough idea of the amount of money that we'll be asking for.
I have to report back to my board something stronger than a rough idea. They're looking for either an exact cost or an NTE, not to exceed number, to fit into our budget. And I guess a lot of this will come together after the town meeting. Our annual meeting for the Water Board is the following week, so we will be in good shape.
What size water line is it now?
There's a mixture there. There's some 4 and some 6.
And is it going to be replaced in kind, or is there going to be upgrades to accommodate for future?
No, we don't put any more 4-inch lines in for mains. It would be...
So the 4-inch would be upgraded to 6-inch?
Yeah, or beyond, depending on the flow that we, the readings that we get.
Bill? Scott?
No,
just... Well, so no, as a follow-up, so we don't know what size is going to be put in its place yet? Or waiting for engineering design, or...?
We're working with an engineering design, yes.
Yeah, I do have a question.
And go ahead. You might have...
Yeah, well, I guess the question I have, though, is I heard the comment that you were looking for either a not-to-exceed or a fixed price. I understand that, but what do we do if the cost exceeds that for the town? Is the town going to be picking up the additional cost?
This circumstance does happen. I've been doing contracts for a lot of years, and every once in a while something comes along. One thing I noticed, I didn't see anything in the proposed costs for removal of ledge, and usually there's a figure in there for ledge. I'm not aware of any, certainly around my property, but further up the road there just might be. The stuff sneaks in on you. And that's one of the variables that we have to look at.
Well, I guess that's the reason why I'm asking is I don't know of any contractor that would do work like this for a fixed price or not to exceed. There's always a clause in there for the unknown. I mean, you get into a place and you got ledge, you got a blast. I wouldn't expect the town to be picking up that expense.
I agree with you.
Carlos? Well, that would be important if there were places where the line wasn't deep enough. Are you proposing to put it deeper? Because, I mean, otherwise, why would you need a blast ledge? We don't know that.
There yet. Will be some different areas as we proceed. Going across the bridge is going to be a diagonal now, and that's a possibility of having a problem. And up the road, I'm not familiar. We haven't done any digging up there, although that water pipe is pretty old. We could have problems tomorrow.
Carl, how do you propose that the invoice is going to be structured then?
Well, I've pretty much told the water precinct that based on comments here and just state law that the town can't do a not-to-exceed. It would have to be a time and materials basis, and I think it's going to be up to the water precinct to decide whether this estimate is worthy of them doing it. I was under the impression that we all kind of agree, yep, this is a reasonable estimate. I mean, as Al said, ledge, nobody can see whether there's ledge there or not. Mm-hmm. So I think we've done a good job of covering it. One of the things that I'm hoping to propose, not tonight, because I think we need to spend some more time with it, but it's going to be in everybody's best interest if we're in and out of there quick. So traffic flow and how we handle the pavement, if you look at that estimate, a good chunk of that money is, there's a lot of money tied up in paving. If we can do some detouring and partial road closures, I think we can save both time and money for both the precinct and the town, because we have a lot of drainage to put in there as well before the road is reconstructed. Mm-hmm. But that'll be a conversation when we come in with the plans and specs for the project at a later date.
Our situation is that our budget is usually ranges between $600,000 and $700,000 a year. Mm-hmm. And if there was a big hit because of a serious problem out there, it would eat up a percentage of our budget to make us delay doing anything else that we would be planning. our budget every year includes about $140,000 for maintenance, and we usually are able to stay pretty close to that, including some emergencies that develop. We have to be on the lookout for that also. It isn't a question of having unlimited funds. We don't. We don't have a backup fund tucked away someplace to pick up the difference. So the board supports the idea of doing it. They're in full support. They have indicated they want to nail down one of the two ideas regarding costing. Mm-hmm. And I think it can be done.
We have one version of a resolution of agreement before us this evening. I assume you have a copy of it there.
Yes. Yeah.
If this board makes a motion to adopt it, you'd be bringing the same motion before your board?
Yes.
The board wish to do this evening on this?
I think Scott has a question.
I'm sorry, Scott.
More towards you, Phil. Has the board ever done anything like this before? I mean, it's unusual for the town, DPW, to be working on a private project. It's a pseudo, well, it's not really, it's kind of public water precinct, but just, it's unusual.
We did do this exact arrangement years ago in Cushing Lane, Cushing Road, when we were redoing New Boston Road, taking care of a drainage issue.
No, I understand the concept of it. I mean, you've got equipment out there and doing drainage, so what's the harm in doing a trench while you're right there doing the drainage work? I mean,
setting the picture for other people watching this discussion, reconstruction of Pleasant Street is scheduled for this coming season.
Hopefully, yes.
Yes. And then, as we've just heard from public comment earlier today, there's a moratorium on opening that pavement for 3 years.
Five on a newly constructed.
Five on newly, okay, so thank you, five. Then the water precinct would be just that much more expensive to replace a water line 5 years in the future, because now it's trenching and paving.
I think there's a little more. I think, as Mr. Gammons pointed out, the age of this. So if the town did Pleasant Street and the water precinct didn't replace this, and there was a problem in this water main next year, 2 years from now, then it becomes much more expensive for the water precinct to do any repair work. So logically, it makes sense to do this all at once. Mm-hmm. And the issue is that they haven't had this in a planning process, and they're dealing with it as a budget amount. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to work together for the citizens, mm-hmm, of Goffstown, taxpayers, and for the customers of Village Water Precinct.
Mm-hmm. One of the kind of history of what we've experienced in the past with these old water mains, too, is, you know, we're going to be out there rebuilding the road with vibratory rollers. We're going to be, you know, putting fabric down under the gravel. And, you know, we've had it happen in the past where the old water main has cracked, whether it's from the vibratory roller or whatever reason, doesn't surface until, you know, the next winter. And then all of a sudden you get water bubbling up out of the road somewhere. And when you put that fabric, it kind of distorts where it's coming from. So it really creates a more complex issue for them to deal with after the fact. So
it makes a lot of sense to do them both together. How often have you seen road work done in the neighboring city where they get the road all done and somebody comes along and digs it up?
Yeah. 2 weeks later.
2 weeks, yeah. Yeah.
Scott.
Carl, you mentioned, If you know, depending on what happens next week with the vote, what is the plan B if, unfortunately, we could get a default budget?
Well, that obviously would be up to the board to
figure out, but if you look at the difference between the town budget and the default budget, obviously something would have to go, something about the size of Pleasant Street. So whether we push Pleasant Street off or we choose to do something else, push something else off, something would have to go. So I don't have a crystal ball. I don't want to make any definitive promises, but that's my thinking, is until we have a budget from town meeting, we don't know for sure what we're doing.
Okay.
I would like to make the recommendation that we delay this project until after town meeting, so that we know if we're working on a good budget, a default budget, so that the plans that are laid are pretty much etched in stone. We don't have to worry about it or come back and change anything at a different time. I'd like to see us hold off. It's another week or two, but we're not going to. When do you plan to start this project, Carl?
Well, all truth be told, I think we're talking about summer, after school.
I mean, we've got a window of time here, and I think if we hold off and make sure we have a good amount of funds, and I'd like to discuss with the board after time and material versus not to exceed. I'm kind of new at it, and I mean, I have questions to ask on that. My recommendation is going to be we hold off.
I mean, I would agree with that. I don't see the urgency right now. I think it's a good idea. It makes sense to do it that way. And you think we need to wait and see what happens after town meeting? And really what we're talking about is basically the town serving as a subcontractor to the water precinct, not to provide materials, just equipment and labor.
Right.
Yes.
And so I don't think a not to exceed works. I think it needs to be based upon actual
time and material.
Time and equipment. Yeah, no materials, but time and equipment.
Time and equipment.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'll accept that as a second to Mark's motion. So the motion is to consider this agreement.
After we have the town voting and see what we actually do have for funds.
Do we need a motion on the vote? What we're going to do is just hold this off.
Consensus to postpone until after town meeting. Yeah.
And I just have one question to Mr. Gammons. Does that do anything for your scheduling as far as your projects or anything?
Not really. We were planning pretty much that the final decision would come after the town meeting and after we have our final session too. If there are some changes that we need to bring up at our annual meeting, that'll be the time we would do it. If there is something, some unforeseen circumstance, such as ledge or anything else, getting rid of the trash. I know we did a project up on High Street a while ago, and boy, that went off like a dream. And everything was dug out, stuff was laid, and refill was put in there that night and paved over.
Yeah.
I forgot about that one.
Yeah. That was
what was that?
High Street. It was a little bit different arrangement where we broke out in the bid. We actually went out to bid, but we included the water main in the bid. Mm-hmm. And I think you paid directly, right?
Yeah. We did.
So the contractor contracted directly with the water precinct for the water work and with the town for the town work.
One of the concerns I have is I have 11 tenants that live right there in that area, and I want to make sure that they do have access to the property. That's something we'll have to work out as a side issue. It's nothing to do with the waterworks, but some of the individuals that live there, and we can work that out too.
Sounds from the discussion we've had here, Mr. Gammons, that this agreement, when we do reconsider it, is going to be time and materials.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to make that. I would suggest that your board consider those terms, and unless you know of another option.
I don't know. We have a pretty good estimate right now based on time and materials. And with a minor modification, to allow for a difficulty to be written in there, I think we can come up with either an NTE or a fixed price. In my lifetime, I worked on a lot of them, and I don't like the NTE because when you give that, it's usually inflated to cover contingencies, which may or may not occur.
And your annual meeting is this month?
It's the Monday after the town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I just want to be clear. I know it's a nuance. We're talking about time and equipment, not time and materials. Mm-hmm. The water precinct's going to provide the materials.
Yes.
So we need some assurances that they're going to have the funds to provide the materials, whatever they might be. Mm-hmm. For instance, if we run into ledge construction, do they have the resources to purchase the materials that are required to deal with those situations? Again, a nuance, but I think it's important.
That's the construction aspect of the trench.
Correct.
I think you've said the actual piping is taken care of.
Yes, it is. Yep.
Fittings and the pipes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but just a follow-up. And you talk about time and material. In here, we have gravel, sand, temporary patch. Is that material that the town is supplying?
That was our anticipation, yeah. I mean, the water precinct has no source for gravel.
Well, I was looking at that and looking at the prices, and I don't think those prices are at the volumes that we purchase.
Right. Yeah, so those materials, the water pipe materials would be the water precinct,
right.
But the earth materials would be us and our paving contractors. And
at what point during this construction, Mr. Gammons, would the connections be made to the residents?
At what point would they be made?
We're putting in a main line for water,
yes.
But then there are the side connections to mm-hmm. the houses.
The program calls for a completion of 160 feet of pipe a day, and that would get us up beyond the bridge.
So the side connections are made while the road is open?
Yes.
Okay. I think that's what I was getting at then.
Yes.
Unlike drainage, water has to be chlorinated and flushed and tested before you can connect the services to it. So it's a couple of steps. But the nice thing about if we're doing it with our in-house staff, while we're waiting for those tests, we can be working on drainage. While we're mm-hmm. digging the water main, if a catch basin goes over here, we can kind of do it as we're going by.
2,000 linear feet, that's what, like a third of them? So is that like, where are we going from to like Westwood or something? Where are
yeah.
we?
Yeah, yeah, that intersection.
Right, Westwood Bog, right around there?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, maybe you could advise me here, Phil, but we've had a motion simply to delay this for probably the second meeting after the election, mm-hmm. because the first Monday, Mr. Gammons is having his board to let his board vote on readiness for such an agreement, and then this can be brought back. So,
Do we need a motion, or do we simply table it?
No.
That's what I'm asking,
yeah,
Phil.
I think part of the difficulty that we have, the water precinct meeting is a week after mm-hmm. our meeting. Mm-hmm. I don't think there is time. If we had a default budget for this board to meet and have a discussion so there would be a resolution of what we're going to do for the water precinct. So I think the best thing to do would be to go forward with this subject to approval at town meeting. That way, when it goes to the water precinct's annual meeting, they'll have something.
Scott?
Well, what's the estimated cost for road reclamation and drainage for this?
I want to say, Scott, that it was
ballpark.
About 100. Well, in house, about 150,000.
Okay. I guess what I'm trying to get to is that if we end up with a default budget, you know, the question is that are we going to spend $150,000 of whatever we have
right.
to do this project in coordination with the water precinct, or are we going to defer it?
See that?
So I just don't. I mean,
part of the unknown for me too isn't the budget; it's the special article on the intersection.
Yeah.
Because if yeah. that, I mean, these two are connected, and so that if that was to fail, that may change how we look at the rest of Pleasant Street.
Just a question: is there any of this water line in that intersection?
Yes, the water main has to go all the way out to South Mass.
Well, I'm sorry, I still have technically a first and a second on a motion.
I'll withdraw my motion, but I tell you, I have my doubts. I kind of agree with Phil. There's time involved here. There's money involved here. Things happen. And we make a decision, and we end up on the default budget.
Consensus for the board.
Wait till after.
This right. needs to be on our agenda.
Right.
Two Mondays after the town meeting.
So we table this and bring it up at that point.
And that allows your board to meet first. Mm-hmm. And
we have a meeting next Tuesday, and then we have our annual meeting, which is the Monday after the town meeting. Mm-hmm. Yep.
So we have a calendar for a date. What would the date on that be?
12th is election day. 19th would be the week after that, and 26th after that.
So. 25th would be the Monday night.
The Monday, right. Okay.
So basically that night, the 25th?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Bring it back on the agenda.
Mr. Gammons, I'll give you opportunity to plug your annual meeting. Who are the people who come to your annual meeting who are eligible to come? I know the public is, but who?
First off, I'd like to clarify something. I've known to everybody as Al, and you make me feel like I should be in here walking around with a cane.
Al.
Or in a chair.
Al. Very, very quickly, who are the voters at your annual meeting?
It depends on what the issues are. If we have an issue in a certain area, and as you know, we have two projects that aren't dependent on our service equipment, although they are getting water from us. If we have an issue with something, then we get a pretty good turnout. If we post the warrant in three places, and sometimes our group is usually maybe a dozen people.
Is it the users or anyone who lives in your district that gets to attend?
Yeah, because Grassmere is different, right? Grassmere is only a certain amount of people vote there.
This is the village water precinct.
Yeah. Different precinct.
Anybody can attend, but we insist that the voters be subscribers.
Okay.
Thank you, Al.
Thank you, David.
For two more weeks.
Yes.
Any further comment? Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. For Al, and we'll.
Yeah, thank you.
Carl, you want to continue our discussion?
Yes. I don't think it's in your packet. I think it was left in your room next door, but we have our annual bid for paving and reclamation. It's a good-sized document that we left in there for the weekend. It's pretty much the standard fare that we've put out the last several years. So with the board's permission, we'll advertise that.
Go back home and resume my supper. Thank you.
So the bids are due back shortly after town meeting once we've gotten our hands around the budget that gets passed. And then the board would be asked to award it that same meeting, I think, that we were talking about earlier on the 25th.
Would the board like to seek bids for paving and reclamation?
So moved.
Second.
Any further questions or comments? Vote, please, on the paving and reclamation bids. Those in favor?
Aye.
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 5-0, Catherine. Motion passes.
The next one is also a typical bid situation that we put out. However, this year, we're asking the board to consider a slight change.
The subject, excuse me, Carl, is aggregate crushing.
That's correct. And normally what we do is we put a bid out to have a private company come in to our pit over the summer and crush all of the materials from road construction that contractors bring into us, old asphalt, concrete, solid rubble. As the board knows, we have been working in the pit all winter, getting it ready to bring materials from the other side of our property that is going to be turned into ball fields at some point. So what we are looking at, and again, this speaks to the tight budget we're working in, we started looking at the possibility of renting just the equipment because we have a crew on site already. We have guys there, and our thought was if we could get the equipment early enough in the season while the guys are still working in the pit, that maybe we could save some money and get
the
material.
People you're referring to is your staff.
Our own crew, yeah. So what you have in your packet, we've gone out and gotten a few estimates. It looks to us like we could save some money by just renting the equipment and manning it with our own labor. What has happened after the 11th hour is I may have a even better price than what's in your packet. So what I would ask the board is to consider the concept. If you're open to the concept, maybe an approval of a not to exceed or something like along those lines. The other piece of equipment that I recently found would be less money. I'm just not 100% sure that it will do the job, and we need some time tomorrow or the next day to verify that it's large enough equipment to do what we need to do. So my recommendation is rather than going out to bid for having a contract come in and crush our material, that we rent equipment to crush it ourselves.
Phil.
Well, a while back we had a discussion regarding a screener. We have that, don't we?
We do.
Now, is the same crew that operates that screener, would they be operating this aggregate crusher?
Yeah, we would need an additional operator for the crushing because you need to feed and take away. The screen we bought is a kind of a one-man operation. This would require two or three people to be involved, and it would only be for a couple of weeks.
But my follow-up question to that, though, is the screening operation has been successful?
Yes. Yeah, it has. That screen's worked out very well. A lot of the material that we're going to process through here has already been run through that screen.
It's the residue.
Yeah, this plant's a little more involved than the screen we have. This is something that's going to crush big pieces of stone, and the screens are like three-way screens that divide the product into several different streams. So it's a little more involved equipment.
So the contractor would provide training for your personnel?
Yes.
On the operation of this?
Yes.
And would there be sufficient personnel time to handle this task without taking them away from other projects and putting other...
As long as we can get on it early, that's kind of the key to it all, is we have to get on it in the next month or so and before the crews move out and start road work. We kind of looked at this as something to do while roads are posted.
So you're looking for us to entertain bids, but allowing for an additional bid or perhaps even multiple additional bids to come in between now and whenever, is that where...
Yeah, I think in the next couple of days we'll be prepared to say yes, this is going to work or not, and sign so we can get in the queue to get the equipment delivered to us as soon as possible.
And bring that information back to the board next Monday?
I'd rather not have to wait till next Monday, but if that's what the board's preference is, we could do that.
No.
Yeah. Carl, on this, is this correct this amount that says that the unit that we're proposing is capable of running 4-inch minus material at 300 tons per hour?
Yes.
Well, when I'm looking up at the companies that you have here, in 2012, quantity is 20 tons. It took them 11 days. And we're going to run 300 tons through a piece of equipment in an hour?
20,000 tons.
20,000 tons, yeah. And mm-hmm. the other thing is it's not like a 10-hour day, the screen's not running for 10 hours. You know, there's time to clean it once in a while. You know, you gotta refuel it. You got to get stuff that's gummed up in there out. So in a 10-hour day, it won't run 10 hours.
Okay, but I guess what I don't understand is this piece of equipment is going to run 300 tons per hour.
Right.
Yet this other company, it says quantity in tons. I assume that's the total tons that they did for us?
20,000, yeah.
It took them 11 days.
Right.
So
is that roughly 200 tons an hour?
Yeah. And the 4-inch minus runs faster than the inch and a half minus.
Because you only have to smash it once.
Right.
Yep.
How many truckloads is that, 300 tons?
Wow, it's a lot.
Yep.
How are we going to can we load 300 tons in?
We don't have to. They're right in our pit. They just, the chute discharges into a big pile.
And stockpiles it right in the pit?
Yeah.
Those storage walls you're about to build?
No, this is even larger than that. These are just the big piles down in the pit floor. Yeah.
That's how it's done now.
Right, right. Yeah, the discharge chute. We'd have a dozer there to push it up once in a while, but it discharges right in place.
I would like the board to proceed on this.
Oh, I'm skeptical of this. I've been supportive of other measures that Carl has brought forward, whether it be the shouldering machine and even the screener. You know, this one, I'm just more skeptical. I have some concerns with it. And I think what's the other opportunity cost lost if we're not doing this, or if there is something that has to come up and we've rented it, I just assume let the experts do the crushing. They've done it in the past, and that's just me. So I'm not going to be in support of this.
That would be business as
usual
for what you've done in previous years for renting, hiring through an RFP for a firm to come in and crush stone.
Which is very easy for us to just put that back out. That's not a difficult RFP to put together.
Yes, Phil?
I understand Scott's concern. The only thing is that we're in a situation where we have to do whatever we can to save money, become more efficient. I think that's been a goal of the board over the last several years. And I would entertain this to try. I mean, we're looking at $38,000 in an outlay of the cash on the budget that we have versus these other costs in the past. Is the lowest one is $54,000. And that is a savings that could be used towards something else.
Mark?
Carl, the number there, $38,000, that would be like the not to exceed amount. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, Mark. I'd like to make a motion, Mr. Chair, to allow the Director, Public Works Director Kyle Quirum, to go ahead and proceed forward with the aggregate crushing, bring the rental equipment in for the not to exceed price of $38,000 in the anticipated two-week time period. Is that right, Kyle?
You hit the high points of...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, are you comfortable with the 2 weeks, or, I mean...
Put approximately.
Yeah.
Okay, approximately 2 weeks.
Because, that, you know, that is what we...
Bad weather.
Yeah.
Nope, I understand.
And our the folks we rent from, they understand that. Yep. So if we had a two-day snowstorm that we were dealing with...
Nope. I understand.
I'll second that with the provision that we have the opportunity to solicit additional bids to try and better the cost savings for the town.
Additional bids for other companies that
Correct.
Rent this
Correct.
Equipment. And you proposed it here. It's agreeable.
I'll agree.
Okay. Further discussion along that line, then. We have a motion.
If I may, Mr. Chair, thank you. If it's going to take two people, two personnel to work this?
Probably three.
three people... I'm assuming, what's the average hourly wage?
We did the math on it, and if we have the three people, we always estimate on our most expensive people. The overall cost would be right in line with that lower price if you factor in our
right.
time and equipment.
Right.
But it comes out of not all road plan, it comes out of our salary line.
And that's kind of where I was going, was that I think in the best case scenario, this is a push. And it also, that means we're going to be the ones who have to feed the equipment, whereas if we hire someone, I'm assuming they're going to use their own machinery. So it's wear and tear on our equipment, gasoline. It would divert resources that we may need. I mean, we talk in our meetings in the last year or so about all these different drainage systems that we have, and I'm not the... person who remembers what their detention ponds that need all this maintenance and things of that nature, and we talk about just road maintenance and shouldering of roads, and I mean things that I guess DPW department, the Departments of Public Works typically do. They typically don't crush rock, and personally, I think this is a push. I don't see this as any savings whatsoever, and it diverts our people away, and I respect the effort to try to save money. I just don't see it in that endeavor. And this equipment, I can just imagine the machine, how it works, how easily it could be to jam. And whereas if it is that this company, they've got to go and they've got to crush X amount of tons for us. That's what we're asking for. And if the equipment breaks down or if there's a jam, it's on their dime. They run that risk. If we do it, it's on ours, and we'll have inexperienced people operating this equipment. Maybe I've been watching too much of that gold mining show on A&E or something, but the bottom line, that stuff breaks down all the time. So I'm skeptical.
Well, if I may, to that point, Carly, I would assume the lease would take into consideration those aspects. If something goes wrong, they're going to get out in a timely manner, repair it, get it back online. I assume all those details would be included in the lease contract.
And, the other thing that, quite frankly, this is more than just trying to save $20,000. Most DPWs don't have a 30-acre pit next door to them that somebody's expecting to turn into an athletic facility. There's a lot of material that needs to be mined out of that. Okay. We carried for years a crushing plant in CIP. This is an opportunity for us to get our construction materials this year, save some money, and find out if it's feasible so that we know whether or not we want to pursue our own crushing equipment when we begin to in earnest work in that expanded pit area. Because that's a lot more material than what we normally would crush.
And if I may, just to address Scott's other concern, I asked the question about whether or not we'd have the personnel to do it and whether we'd be diverting them from other tasks, and I think your response was no. We can work it out and still meet our other obligations and accomplish our other tasks and work.
I mean, I don't want to say that there's not something being put in the back burner, because we always have something
understood.
That
Otherwise,
we're doing.
Otherwise, there'd be people standing around doing nothing.
Right.
I don't want to belabor this too much. Kilton Barnard told me, and I think he told a lot of people when this land was purchased, that the materials that are on his site, for the most part, are very sandy, are gravel, and then we're not talking about huge boulders or rocks that have to get crushed. So in terms of reclaiming that particular land for the ball fields, this is not something that we would anticipate seeing a lot of rocks or boulders that you're going to have to crush. The minerals there were mostly topsoil, sand, gravel. And from what he expressed to us, and I think from what we saw even from the Perry pit, was it is pretty much that. There's not a whole lot of crushing that you need to do. The crushing is really based upon the reclaim stuff that we take off our roads, more so than what's coming out of that pit. So,
well, I'll question myself and then Phil. If the town were to have an RFP to bring in a firm to crush the stone, how prepared are you to have 20,000 tons ready for them to crush? Has that already been assembled?
Yeah, oh yes. Yeah.
So it's been assembled whether if we bring somebody in to crush it,
correct,
or we allow rental of equipment with your staff to crush.
Yeah, I could be prepared to advertise the standard RFP tomorrow morning, and it's ready to go.
Yeah, and when we mining the other areas that we're going to, that we have been looking at plans for doing, that stuff's got to get sifted anyway. So what gets sifted out when you're separating your gravel, you're going to have your gravel screen is coming out, and you're going to have residue that gets kicked over onto the side that's going to be larger rocks. Yes, you do have gravel. You might have a lot of gravel that varies from, let's say, 1 inch to 3 inches, but you are going to get pieces in there that are 6 inch. They're going to get kicked out to the side, and at some point, those are going to have to get crushed. I mean, you're going through quite a bit of material. To say that we're going to go through all that material, we're never going to find 6 inch rocks or bigger, I think is not reality.
Thank you, board members. Lots of discussion. So if I can, I believe the Catherine can look at your minutes, but I believe the motion was to rent a stone crusher for approximately 2 weeks, not to exceed
$38,000. I think it was for approximately 2 weeks.
Yeah, yes, yep. Approximately 2 weeks, $38,000.
Okay. And to allow the DPW director to entertain additional bids
as well.
In order to get the best price for the town.
Normally that, yes. So motion, that's the motion, the rent. Those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Those opposed?
No.
Actually, I'm no as well, but so the motion carries 3-2. Okay, crack sealing, asphalt sealing of cracks on the road.
Yes, this is our standard bid that we put out last season. We opted not to do this to save money. However, this year we definitely should do it. So we've updated the list with all of the roads that have been paved and reclaimed in the last couple of years as we normally would. I expect this to be about a $100,000 project at the end of the day.
So this was followed in your budget, Carl?
Yes.
Even under default budget?
Yes. Yeah, I would definitely recommend doing this first.
We won't have the same issues this year as we had last year with the crack seal coming up, will we?
If we get it out early enough, we shouldn't.
Well, that's all I want to ask.
Yeah.
Thank you, Carl.
Any further discussion before somebody makes a motion?
Yeah, I do.
Yes.
Again, I look through this, and obviously I go to the roads that I know. One's my road, and one is the road right next, I have two roads. And I look at that and I see Range Road, and the road just needs to get reclaimed. I mean, you could crack seal from the morning till, you could crack seal for 3 weeks straight, you would, and it's just horrible, the road.
The only, section of Range is what we overlaid last year.
Okay.
Just the new section.
And then that becomes a question, because when I look at that, that's 6,198 square yards, which doesn't seem right.
Yeah, it probably isn't.
And then I go to the other road, and it's Aileen, and I say to myself, why are we crack sealing Aileen? They just put a new top coat on. There aren't any cracks. So I don't quite get it. So we're crack sealing one road that has so many cracks you can never crack seal. The other one is brand spanking new to overlay. I don't quite.
Well, what the contractors get, just to put your mind at ease, is they actually get some photographs that say, do not crack seal this. And the photograph they get is Lindsay Way, that looks very much like the section of Range you're talking about.
Right.
The reason we'd want to crack seal the other end of Range and Aileen is, crack sealing's all about, it's like painting your house. You want to, if there's just one little crack in that road, we want to seal it before water gets in it, because if we let water get in, then next year there's three cracks, and the year after that there's 10 cracks. So we literally do every single street that we've overlaid or reclaimed in the past with crack seal, because we're paying, even doing it by the square yard, we pay about 10 cents a square yard to go and seal all the cracks. It's pennies on the dollar compared to a thin overlay or any other treatment we might do for maintenance. It literally is like painting your house. If you keep up with the painting, it saves you a lot of costly repairs later.
I'm prepared to make a motion to approve the release of the RFP.
I'll second his request for the RFP for crack sealing.
Okay. No further discussion necessary. Are those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. 5-0. And finally, you want the board to review the street excavation ordinance and possible amendments to that.
Yeah, as we mentioned earlier, amending an ordinance is no small task. But I do think that the ordinance needs to have a provision for the board to be able to consider a special case scenario, which it does not have currently. As we looked into it, I also discovered, as I reviewed the ordinance several times, there are just some minor changes that we should make that are just out of sync. The ordinance was originally drafted in 1998. So there's a few things that are spelled out in there that are a little out of sync with our practice today. So I wanted to make those adjustments. And in talking to Sue, while we're doing this, would be the ideal time to just reformat this to avoid it in the future, where we craft the ordinance part as a very generic ordinance, and then have rules that go along with that ordinance that are much easier to amend. So kind of restructuring the thing to follow the format of our ordinances that we create today, I think, would be in order as well. So what I would be prepared to do is, if the board advertises a public hearing, we could restructure the thing between now and then, and it would be presented at the first public hearing, and then we'd launch down the road of amending the ordinance.
Yeah, most of this is procedural. It shouldn't really be in an ordinance.
So the action really is to authorize to go forward with public hearings, to hear...
And for Carl to draft.
To hear comment from the public on particular needs from residents about the ordinance. And you will make presentations for those public hearings about your proposed changes as well.
Correct.
So as far as the timing goes, when could we expect a draft for our consideration before setting up the rest of the time frame?
Yeah.
I guess that's a question for you. When will you have time to redraft this?
Well, my thought was that for next week's packet, we could have the draft language. And okay. I don't think we need, that doesn't get advertised, right?
The draft language doesn't. You just advertise a public hearing. Yeah. And you have to have the public hearing ad in the newspaper a week before the public hearing.
Understood, but before we get into the public hearing schedule, we want to make sure we know what the draft is going to be.
Right, you want to be comfortable with draft first.
Yeah, so we want to review that.
How much time it's going to take? We can get a draft next week? Then.
Yeah.
Okay.
We can make comment for the following week.
Consensus of the board then, bring back a revision of this?
Do we need to advertise before then?
I think they want to wait on the advertisement until they see a draft.
Yes. The board wants to see a draft first, and then we'll pick the dates for the public hearings.
Phil? And what we have in our, what we have here is the way it exists, with no proposed change, because
there are
no red lines or at the
right.
No.
This right. This is the existing. Current one.
Yep.
Any further subjects?
Not for me. I understand the chief wants me to hang around, though, for the first part of his.
Is that for moral support?
Yes.
Or in his case, immoral support.
Well, Chief Sullivan, you're here. You're the chair of the Highway Safety Committee.
Yes.
And you have some recommendations for us to consider.
We had a meeting, I think it was 2 weeks ago. The first thing, and I've asked Carl, he's been involved in the discussions between the exit 6 and 7 off of 293 and the possible impact it's going to have on our community as they go forward with that project. And I turn over to Carl at this point.
I think one of the things that that we talked about at Highway Safety is the need as a community to support the project, even though it resides within the city of Manchester. It's of critical importance to the town of Goffstown, particularly the component if Exit 7 is relocated north of its current location, and there are several proposals that would move Exit 7 to above the landfill and above the community college, and there would be a new full-service interchange just above that area. It would tie over to East Dunbarton Road at a minimum. However, one or two of the alternatives also have it tying over to Goffstown Back Road. That, of course, is the piece that is most advantageous to the town of Goffstown. The status of that project right now is it's in a preliminary planning study. Our anticipation is that one or two forms of that will go into the next phase of the project, which would be the environmental assessment phase of the project. There's really no reason to eliminate the connection of Back Road today. However, at our last meeting, it's not a overwhelmingly convincing.
The last meeting you're speaking of is a
steering committee meeting.
Steering
I'm sorry.
Committee.
Yeah. So I think it's really important right now for the town of Goffstown to show our support and show our support for the project and show our support for continuing the endeavor. So one of the things I think that I would like to ask, and I think the Highway Safety agreed, we're in the process now, we being the Greater Manchester area, are in the process of redrafting the state's 10-year plan. Southern New Hampshire Regional Planning has asked communities for their input on projects to be considered in the 10-year plan. So Brian Rose and myself are working on a list of projects that we would submit to that effort. And one of those projects that obviously we should as a town support is Exit 6 and 7. So I wanted to stick around and answer any questions that you may have and again get the board to consider supporting that project.
And this is this was discussed at Highway Safety.
Yes, it was. It was a
Did he, Carl just summarize that, or do you have
certainly
some?
Certainly did, and very eloquently, too, okay. I should say.
You're not going to add anything to that, then? Phil, comment?
Yeah, this is, I'm going to bring this up for a discussion here. Since you mentioned the arguments for the interchange going to Goffstown Back Road, if the interchange is a large interchange and it goes to East Dunbarton Road, that is going to make it more accessible for people to get off there, take East Dunbarton Road through Twist Hill and bypass the toll, as so many people do right now. Because that, my understanding is East Dunbarton Road is, and I'm not sure if it was you or Megan said the width of the road is how many rods?
Oh, the right-of-way?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's got some pinch points in it.
Yeah, but it's a relatively, my understanding, it's an old stagecoach road between Concord and Manchester.
Yeah.
And it goes directly to the Capitol and beyond. But so many people use it to avoid the toll. So by having, increasing the interchange onto East Dunbarton Road, they might be, I hate saying it, I just bring this up for discussion because you're asking for it. So would it make more sense for them to put it onto Goffstown Road, or would that have them have a toll on East Dunbarton Road like they do at the Hooksett Toll? I just didn't know if that might be food for thought as part of the argument to make it go on to Goffstown Road versus East Dunbarton Road.
Well, all of the scenarios that have been evaluated, it has to cross East Dunbarton to get to Back Road.
Yeah.
So they all
right. So East Dunbarton. That might not be viable.
There is some, whether the interchange goes straight through to Back Road and East Dunbarton tees into it, or whether the interchange goes straight through to East Dunbarton and the connection tees, which would be based on traffic volumes and what makes the most sense.
Okay. But just a thought.
Yes.
East Dunbarton is going to experience some growth of traffic. If you put a major interchange feeding in to the west, is going to, the first major crossroad on that is going to be East Dunbarton.
The amount of traffic that's already up there, you don't realize it.
The other option is that access road from the interchange then continues Goffstown Back Road.
Yeah, no, I understand. I was just,
how do you're proposing that this be a resolution from the, or encouragement from this board to bring something back to the steering committee? Or,
you know, that when highway safety discussed it, this was the only thing in discussion, I think. After today's discussion with Brian Rose, we're probably going to have a letter that involves more than just this project, but this Exit 6 and 7 is going to be probably the top priority for the region. Mm-hmm. So obviously, you know, we're asking the board to support that. I think there are some other projects as well, so what I would guess we'll do is prepare a letter for the board's signature. That would go to Southern Hampshire Planning from the board with the projects, unless you're opposed to supporting it.
I am the board's representative for that, also a steering committee with you, and I've been attending most of those meetings that you have been gathering information from and part of that steering committee. And I see the impact that this town's going to have with a new interchange and redesign of the Emeski interchange as well. And we need to anticipate that impact and, well, so in one hand, take advantage of it as far as what development, economic development might come out of that, but also be aware that it has negative impact and try to modify that to our advantage. Mm. So I personally will look forward to a letter being drafted, brought to the board. Any other views on that?
No, I mean, I'd like to see a draft as well. I think we have to look at it in the bigger picture as well. We've already got problems with the Elm Street, High Street, Main Street intersection. This is going to bring more pressure on that intersection. So, I agree that we need to look at the bigger picture.
I'm very concerned about East Dunbarton being a commuter route from a potential new interchange, which essentially runs parallel to our eastern border towards Concord and Dunbarton.
There always has been since its existence.
But it would be more than it is at present, because now you're having a full interchange feeding into it from 293.
A lot of benefits to the neighborhood area, too, to get onto the highway that eliminates it on Straw Road and some of the other ways.
Then consensus of the board, I've been hearing to bring that letter forward, you in coordination.
Give it a couple of weeks, what I'm hearing. So we better get cracking.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the information on 6 and 7. And now, Chief Sullivan, you take over for those highway safety recommendations.
Yes, we had one request for a dead-end sign on Heald Street, on Laurel Street at the intersection of Heald. This is a very short road that's experienced quite a bit of traffic lately. Apparently, there may be some GPSs that actually direct people up the dead end. So we're asking for a dead end street to be mounted on the pole adjacent to the street sign. And all members of the committee were in favor of that.
Mm-hmm. Mark.
Motion to accept Chief Sullivan's recommendation for a dead end.
Highway safety.
For a dead end sign. Heald and Laurel Street to be placed.
I'll second it.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 5-0, Catherine.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And the final one, it's like the bad penny. It keeps coming back.
Do we? What time will we adjourn this evening? Go ahead. Start out.
This is the townwide speed limit. That's come back up. I believe this is the third time since I've been chief. We've brought it up before. We've expanded the roads that have different speeds other than the 30 mile an hour for the townwide. We've increased it on Gosstown Back Road to 35 between Jason and the Manchester line. Speed limit on 30 is 35 on Wallace between Stacy and the Bedford line. Speed limit on Shirley Hill Road between 114 and Wallace Road be 35. Speed limit on Tibbetts to Loring, from Loring to Blackbrook would be 35. Speed limit on East Dunbarton to Blackbrook, 35. And the speed limit on Terrell between Center and Monolona would be 35. These affect most of the major commuter routes that bumped up to 35 instead of the 30 that we would propose for the townwide speed limit. And they would be posted as such. The state roads, such as 114, would not be affected. They're state-maintained roads, and the speed limits are set by the state on those roads.
Question.
Yes, Phil.
Chief, on the B, on the statement of regulation, Center Street between Tibbetts Hill and Terrell Hill, the roundabout's 15.
That's a suggested speed.
So the suggested speed in front of headquarters is?
I believe it's 35.
I thought it was 40.
That's the speed limit in front of headquarters is 40. I believe it's 30 or 35 in front of headquarters.
Does that remain the same?
Yes.
And the other, Page Hill? Not on here. Page Hill beats the.
We kept Page Hill off because of going up the curves in there. It's just, they're too severe.
Okay.
There's one short stretch between Brenda Lidge.
Currently is 35.
Yes.
Does this ordinance need to express that it doesn't include the state highway?
This says unless otherwise posted, the state highways would be posted.
Where's the other as otherwise posted? You're suggesting that otherwise means state?
Right here.
If it's posted with a difference, it's under number three.
That's it.
Or specifically exempted.
I would like to see something in there that says the otherwise posted or specifically exempted, something that deals with the fact that it's a state highway, class 3 or 4. And there's a short portion of a state highway in this inside our borders that has a 50-mile-an-hour limit on it. Granted, it's only for 100 yards.
I think it's still 45 in there, but that's...
Take a ride towards Parker Station Road.
Okay.
To the bridge.
Yeah, I'm thinking the other end. You're correct. I guess my concern is if you start naming state roads, you're expecting people from...
I don't mean to name all the state roads, but acknowledge in here that the state roads are posted by state authority. Okay. I believe that statement was correct, right? The state roads outside of the compact areas...
Right, and that's the problem. Because
posted by state, this town, we don't manage that.
Right, but if you're from Massachusetts and you're coming up to go visit Ware on Route 114, you may not understand what the compact area is, and that would be my concern.
This is an ordinance specifying speed limits on town roads.
Correct.
But do we have to, should it, do we need to explain in here that what we call town roads are not the state portions of state highway?
We can certainly include it.
Any other comments on this proposed ordinance?
Chief, I know that you've been here before on this one, but for those who are watching on TV, what is the benefit of having a townwide speed limit? I mean, Bedford has one, obviously, can you explain
certainly
what the benefits are?
It's more unified or uniform across the town. People, number one, know what they're coming into as far as it's posted on each border that Goffstown has a townwide speed limit of 30 miles an hour unless otherwise posted. In addition to that, we spend less money on signs. Instead of putting signs up on every road, we have them at the borders. Additionally, we also get numerous issues that come before the Highway Safety Committee dealing with speed issues. We'd like our road on X road to be down to 25. We'd like ours to be down to 40. We'd like it this way. It's a more uniform approach as far as all the roads in town maintain one speed limit, unless we've identified it within the ordinance.
If a road is not specifically signed for a speed limit, what's the default?
It would be 30 miles an hour on this.
No.
Currently, it's going to depend if it's residential, urban, and the list goes down. I believe there's 5 different categories that it could be.
So that we had, I know, what was it, a year ago, like in the Cinnamon Woods area, which is on here, right? I thought it was on here. Didn't we reduce that to 25?
We did.
They were. They are 25. The spices are 25.
Okay. Is that on here or no?
No, it is not.
So it would go to 30?
Correct.
Okay. And the last time that you were here, if I'm not mistaken, you added some of these other roads and you raised them from 30 to 35 on
correct.
Some of the
we've
commuter
added,
type roads.
Yes, I believe we've added the last three or four. In
okay. If I could make a comment, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I was kind of against this the last time around. I think that you've done a really good job addressing the more the commuter type routes in this. I would think that if we had a public hearing, others may express acceptance of this or may suggest tweaking it to a degree, but I think I understand, you know, the essence of what you're trying to do. I didn't support it the last time because I thought that 30 miles an hour for some of these commuter roads just didn't seem practical. I think you've addressed that here. And I think the uniformity piece, I think, is easier not only for the officers. I think it's easier just for the community to know that the vast majority of roads is going to be a 30-mile-an-hour speed limit. And it seems to be pretty fair. And I wouldn't mind going through a public hearing or two just to get the public's input on it and see what they have to say.
Yeah, I support this. I just want to touch upon something Phil brought up, and it's the yellow signs with the speed limit on it. Those are suggested safe driving speeds,
correct.
Not enforceable speed limits.
Correct.
Just want to make sure the folks who may be watching understand the difference between those two signs.
I told my daughter the wrong thing. I apologize.
Your daughter.
She was learning to drive.
She can go 30 miles an hour through the round.
No. It's no. 15. It's 15.
Yeah. Chief, how have you considered the signage for, let's say, Riverview Park?
That would be at the town border, so it would be at the border as you go down into Riverview.
And that would be 30.
Correct.
Are there any 25s in there now?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. And then there are a couple of smaller sections that are over in Pinardville.
Violet Street, are you talking
yeah,
about?
Yeah, that area.
That would also have to be posted as well.
Okay. But do you see any issues? I guess the concern, is there any way that somebody could come in from some area and not see a sign that says 30 miles.
We would have to ensure that that wasn't. That
you could have Mr. Chairman Pierce do that. He did a really good job with the preambulation, right? All those signs, the one that's, there's two right next to each other.
Well, there's a lot of them are missing. There's no sign that says welcome to Goffstown when you're coming from Dunbar. It's gone. Or probably in a dorm room.
Big billboard
sign.
We digress.
Extra Phil. Welcome.
We're digressing. Someone was whispering. The board's consensus, we should proceed with posting public hearings on this ordinance.
Yes. I think there's a good give and take here. I mean, I'm sure there might be some people who would have liked to have seen some roads stay at 25 that are now 30 and some, but I think that there was a lot of thought that went into this, and there may be a few comments from the public that might tweak it, but I think it's pretty good.
I do have one question. I just caught on to this, but I thought on D, speed limit on South Mass between Mountain Road and Park Lane is 25, and Elms Main Street in front of Town Hall is
25.
Yeah. Okay, why does it? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, that's going the opposite way. Yeah, that's just beyond the roundabout. Okay, so basically from the roundabout to the library is 25. Okay. Because we had a lot of those residents that had come in at various occasions.
And that was part of it to address their concerns with
right.
this.
Okay.
So, is this something we can post then
for a public comment.
We can proceed to advertise it for a public hearing. It wouldn't be for two, well, 3 weeks extra.
Need a motion to that effect? Make that motion.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I'll make that motion to advertise for the public hearings to solicit public input on the proposed ordinance. Thank you.
How many are we required to have? One, right?
What?
Public hearing.
Two
public hearings. Okay.
2 weeks apart.
All right.
2 weeks apart. And then we're not allowed to make a decision until 2 weeks after the second one.
I think it was 10 days to 10 to 14.
Yeah, but it works out to two.
Works out to be 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Unless we were to have an out-of-cycle meeting. I have a motion.
I'll second it.
Thank you. Further discussion?
Just one thing. I would like to see us pretty heavily advertise these hearings. I think it would be good so that folks know that they can provide input and they can, you know, tweak this to a degree. I can imagine some people would be very much for this, and there'll be others who will be against it, but at least everybody has an opportunity to state their opinion if we publicize it well. Someone won't say, oh, the selectmen, they pass an ordinance under the cover of night, and I wouldn't want that to be the perception.
We'll get an article written in the paper, yeah. Do a press release.
Right, yeah. Something.
Try to get it on our sign as well.
Yeah.
The information content here is also ideal for a geographic information system display of where these B through J roads are. And then the roads I spoke of, which are state maintained, where they are. But presenting that on a sketch of the whole town, a few roads would be colored one color for 25s or 35s, others a third color, that these are state highway roads, not affected by this ordinance. Put up on our
and
website.
And everything else would be 30. So
have it available
on our website. Yeah.
And so please work with the town IT staff to have something like that made. Speaking as a former cartographer, I always have to get in maps one way or the other.
Yes, I have.
Speaking of public awareness, and I know Carl's not here, but could we use the reader boards for Election Day and remind people? Because a lot of, believe it or not, a lot of people don't even, I mean, what do we have, 20% voter turnout? I mean, if we could use the reader boards or maybe get it on, if you could ask permission from the Patrolmen's Association to remind people to vote next Tuesday, that would be a good thing. Because a lot of people, they vote in the presidential elections at 80%.
I can just clarify, it's the Police Association. Police Association is not a union. The Patrolman right. Association is yeah. a union.
Okay. So Police Association.
It's a Police Association.
Yeah. Yes, Phil.
Chief, this goes to the reason, goes back to my questioning about the Mass Road 25. C and D are what threw me off. And I understand that you probably have them because South Main Street, the names of 114, but would it be, is it possible to combine C and D to make it simpler?
I mean, we could make that whole stretch 25.
I mean, it is. It's just that, and what throws it off is when you get to...
That's the addresses, though.
You're talking about Mountain Road and High Street. So, okay, so you understand Mountain Road to High Street, which is Main Street.
Right.
Okay, but then the next one, it takes it the opposite way, which when you're looking at it, because you're taking from Mountain Road to Park Lane, so you're taking it from two different directions rather than as a front. And that's what threw me completely off.
Have the flow of the words in the same direction.
Right.
Right. So High Street would come before Mountain Road. And then it should be okay, right?
Well, unless there was a specific reason that they had it that way.
No. But we'll just straighten that out.
That way it's clear, because when you look at it, you say, okay, from Mountain Road to it's over there. But if I'm going the opposite way, is it
almost
right.
different in the opposite direction?
Good observation.
25, then to 30, then to 40.
We will.
Any other recommendations from the committee?
Yeah, that was it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
This was a rather short agenda for your committee. Usually there's five or six issues to be discussed.
Very short meeting.
As long as you can promise to take down 30 signs, then we're good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item on the agenda. We're running behind schedule, aren't we? 7 o'clock item. Acceptance of $25 donation from the Ryan Wood Condominium Association for the Grassmere Town Hall Restoration Fund.
Motion to accept the $25 donation from Ryan Wood Condominium Association for the Grassmere Town Hall Restoration Fund.
Second.
Further discussion? Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
5-0.
Would you like to skip to item 8A? Since the chief is here, and not to hold him up for the rest of the evening.
Yeah, he has American Idol he's watching tonight, so. It's probably 8 o'clock.
Gotta get going.
Yes. Chief, please come up then. Is this part of our tonight's packet?
Yes. 8A. It's the revised ambulance policy. The chief took into consideration the comments of the board last week.
Lead off, chief.
Okay, thank you. First of all, one of the comments was the term write-off, and Don Bohr from finance was attempting to find a term that best suited the auditors, and we came to the conclusion that using the term abatement would be appropriate, since that's what they use in their letter to the town at that time. So whenever you saw the term write-off or concerned as write-off, we changed that word to account abatement. Mm-hmm. And on page number 2, that term also is reflected in that flow chart. And also one of the concern and possibilities to highlight was to, before going to collections, was looking into the possibility of sending a letter of possible legal action to the account holder or the patient that's responsible for the charge before going to collections. And we have been talking to Carrie Stickelish to give us some input on the proper way to word things and processes. And what you have here is what we were able to get.
Chief O'Brien, thank you for the rewrite, and we'll turn it over to the board members. Any questions or comments on this version?
Just one. Could we peg, I don't know where, the one with the chart has the Health and Human Services liquid assets criteria? That's as of this year.
Yes.
So is your plan that you're going to revise this every single year because the Medicare rates are going to change every year, so you would just change this as well? Or do you want to peg it to something?
We can word it to say this is an example of the chart that is typically used, and this is the fiscal year 2013 charge.
Right. So my point is that
the chart would be adjusted annually based upon something. Yes. If you look at right after that chart, you see note the above eligibility criteria may be adjusted to conform to updates
from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't see it there.
But more than likely, you would come before the board every year, and you're going to be making adjustments to these rates and that on an annual basis, I would
think. Correct. These are the two areas. You're exactly right. The AMLS rates are revised annually if there is an increase. We just got notified today that because of the sequester, that the Medicare is cutting the ambulance transport reimbursements 2% starting immediately. So, again, that's why it's really important to adjust our rates as quick as possible. But you're right, and then we'll be looking at these eligibility criteria income rates at the same time.
I didn't notice this last week, but I have now. Is there a need for the precision of your rates to be to the penny? How did you derive something to the penny?
Again, it comes to Medicare-established rates. Medicare establishes those rates to the penny.
Okay, that's where it came out of another document. Okay,
we can't make this stuff up.
Our department heads do everything to the penny. If you look at the cost of sand and gravel in the thing with the village water precinct, it was 0.98 yards down to that. Okay.
Exactly.
Just trying to understand the source of it.
Sometimes it's easy, sometimes it's difficult.
They're sharpening
too much information.
To make a motion, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
To approve the fire chief's recommendation with respect to ambulance service rates and patient billing and our collection policy for the town of Goffstown.
Second.
Okay. Further discussion necessary?
Nope.
Chief. Call for the vote on the motion, please.
Those in favor?
Aye.
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 Five. Great job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good for another year.
Good for. See you next year.
We'll see what happens. The government doesn't shut down.
But nobody yet. If the next sequester deal, you'll be coming back. We've got to raise it now 2.3%.
Well, we need to go back. It's now 7:05. Town administrator's report.
Your weekly meeting schedule this week is light. It's Wednesday. Is EDC. Consensus folder tonight, your weekly manifest. AP is $842,743.58, and your payroll and withholding manifest is $163,579.89. You also have thank you letter to Selectman Demanza for his generous donation to the Grassmere Statue Fund. Mm-hmm. Thank you letter to Elizabeth DuBrul for service on HDC. Event permit for Bartlett PTA Easter Bunny Breakfast on March 23rd, a deposit voucher for Grassmere Town Hall Restoration Fund, an employee status form to promote a part-timer to a full-time fireman.
So moved to accept.
Second.
Vote for the consensus folder, please. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 5-0.
Thank you. And the assessor recommends elderly exemptions on Map 6, Lot 17B-27 and 17B-67.
Motion to accept the assessor's recommendations.
Second.
Favor. Those in favor of the assessor's recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
5-0.
Thank you. You have requests for out-of-state travel. Chief O'Brien has been selected to represent the New Hampshire Fire Chiefs at the annual National Fire Chief and Emergency Services Dinner and Seminar Program, Washington, D.C., for an overnight. There is no cost to the town.
So moved.
Second.
Those in favor of the request for out-of-state travel, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And Public Works Director.
That's a good honor.
Yes, it is.
Very good honor. Public Works Director Kyle Quorum requests authorization to travel out of state to two annual conferences. One is the APWA International Congress and Exposition in Chicago, Illinois, as the New England delegate for APWA and Center for Sustainability, and the New England APWA Chapter Summer Conference in Lenox, Mass., and that's for 3 days. And those are all in his budget.
Those are all in the budget?
Yes.
The conference in Lenox, Mass., does that include accommodations, or is that going to be day trips?
No, that includes accommodations.
So move to accept.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? Those in favor of the motion on the out-of-state travel, please say aye.
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 Thank you. In response to your inquiry of the cost of Bluetooth, which we discussed last week, it would be about $1,000.
Total for everybody?
Yep, there's 25 municipal employees with municipal cell phones and driving municipal vehicles.
You know, the only concern, though, that I have, you need to consider that if we're going to be providing Bluetooth, then we are promoting the use of cell phone while driving.
Mm-hmm.
Hands-free.
I understand, but it's still a distraction.
I don't have a problem with it.
I don't have a problem with it, and as a matter of fact, I would hope that any future vehicle purchases we have, that will be part of the specs, is hands-free. It's in so many cars. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It just makes common sense that, you know, people are going to be conducting, you know, business while, you know, driving. I mean, but you want to do it in a safe way, and that's the safest way you can possibly do it.
Question, where would that cost come from? Has that been budgeted somewhere?
No, it has not been budgeted.
So where would the cost come from?
Which budget?
It would come from
each department.
Each department's budget.
But out of which year?
Communication.
It's coming out of a budget that hasn't been approved.
Right.
Okay. I'm not going to say any more.
I'll wait till after town meeting to see where we are.
I don't know. I mean, you know, my take, I mean, on a $19 to $20 million budget, I mean, we've come up with monies here and there. This is $1,000. I think it's the right thing to do for our employees. It's the right thing to do
for them. We should have budgeted for it.
But you know what? You don't budget for every damn thing. We didn't budget for radios and all this other stuff, but we have to find a way sometimes when it makes sense. I mean, I think this is not just a safety issue for our employees. It's a public safety issue for others. And
we have a policy that states that we don't encourage the use of cell phones while driving, and now we're changing the policy by doing this and not even changing the policy. You should address the policy first, and they should be done together. So this is overriding a policy that's written.
I'd recommend that the policy be written with this in mind, but bring back a time frame for implementation. Whether it's like 50% out of this year's budget, you know, 2013. If the policy was rewritten just black and white, it would have to be immediately implemented.
Right.
And vehicles would have to be retrofitted. Was that your intent?
My point is that it's a reality that our employees are using these phones while driving, and whether it's encouraged or discouraged, et cetera, it's just a safer thing for our employees, and I think right now we're almost like giving a wink and a nod to our employees. We're not encouraging it, but we know you're doing it. And if we know that they're doing it, then I think it would be prudent to give them the opportunity to use a hands-free device. And I just don't, you know, for all that we do in the 6 years that I've been on this board, it's one thing to find $10,000 or $20,000 or $100,000. To find $1,000 in our respective budgets, it's very doable. And I just think, and if that requires a change in the policy with an implementation schedule, I'm fine with that. That makes sense. You should amend the policy.
Board could help me understand one thing. A car I purchased 3 months ago came with this capability already installed, and it's a button on my steering wheel.
Right.
How is this retrofitted?
There's two. You have two different types. I mean, one obviously you can use is in your ear, and then the other one is a mounted
Right onto the dash.
You put on the visor
or, you know.
I agree that we ought to revisit the policy, and we ought to revisit the term cell phones, because it's bigger than cell phones, which is what you're talking about. It's not a cell phone. You know, we need to term it in
hands-free
in the sense of hands-free communications, whatever those might be, mm-hmm. you know, to allow for future.
Okay, I'll work up something, bring it back. 7 New Hampshire Planning Commission has sent us a letter about the Municipal Sharing Grant Project. They're seeking two representatives from the town to serve on the advisory committee, and the positions they named are either elected officials from the Board of Selectmen or Budget Committee, or the town administrator or finance official. It would be beneficial, to have one of each, one elected member and one staff person. And if you go in that direction, I'd be willing to serve as the staff person on this.
What is the sharing?
To look at regionalization.
Okay.
And shared resources and between towns.
So, for instance, going after a grant cooperatively with neighboring towns?
That would be one example. Sometimes they were even getting into purchasing and purchasing as a larger group to get better pricing on certain commodities.
Electrical power source regionally. A lot of things could be regionally purchased.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah. I'll move that motion then.
I'll second it.
Okay. So, one would someone from the board want to serve on this board?
Can we wait till we have a new board?
Okay, we can do that. So I can just tell I'm a member of a board and I would serve.
The motion is a member of the board and the town administrator.
Okay.
And then they.
That's fine.
Who actually attends could be varied every 6 months.
Okay.
As needed.
So Scott made the motion, and who seconded?
Collis.
Collis, thank you.
Collis. Those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
5-0.
Thank you. In close, you'll find the responses from DES regarding the two properties which were to be tax deeded based upon a response from DES. It appears that this probably satisfies the board's requirement. Therefore, the tax collector will proceed with the tax deeding of 2 Water Road and 2 Shore Drive.
I have a question.
Lead off, please.
We had a comment in the packets, I believe it was from the town administrator, regarding the property, a large parcel, with the filling of the wetlands. If the filling of the wetlands was going to be waived as a violation, so does this mean that they have no violation?
They have no violations, yeah. They have no recorded violations on these properties.
Okay, but
that was just an observation from someone who did the site walk, saying this appears like someone must have filled this.
Oh, well, that's okay.
But it wasn't.
Okay, so we have no recorded violation
right.
of. Okay.
Also, the tax collector reports that the board agreed to a taxpayer payment plan to catch up on 2008 property taxes. The plan was monthly payments of $400 starting in September 2012. At this point in time, the town should have received six payments, but it's only received two. The property is manufactured housing, and the person is residing in the home. Tax collector sent another letter, but has not seen another payment.
So there's no response, or no, that's too bad.
I know.
You know, you try to work with people.
I'll make a motion that we proceed with a tax lien.
I'll second that.
Tax deeding?
Tax deeding, yeah.
I have a motion to, do we need to identify the parcel number?
It is. She doesn't have the parcel number. She has the address. Oh, wait a minute. Here it is. Map 6, lot 22-75.
So I have a motion to proceed with tax deeding map 6, lot 22-75.
One comment. I just want to let the record reflect that these taxes are 4 years overdue. The town entered into a settlement in good faith with a payment plan, and that payment plan was not honored. And that is why I am making the motion.
And this is tax deeding for the structure.
Right.
Not for the rental land.
So we would have to enter into an agreement with Medville regarding that we will not be subject to rental.
Yeah. And we have that process that's been mapped out
before. We've done that before.
Right. It's all mapped out and... Okay.
Yeah, this will be unique in that this person is still living there.
So. The other two were vacant.
Vacant properties.
Right, and I think also for the viewing public that statutorily it's 3 years. This is going into the fourth year because there's been an agreement and there was no response from the letters that have been out from Mr. Ingalls.
It was unfortunate. The two we did a year ago, they had been vacant for a considerable period of time, and when we did auction the properties off, we could not recoup the tax money because they had been not in non-payment status for
we didn't recoup all our money, very little of it.
So four years is certainly time to take action. Okay, I have the motion for tax deeding map 6, lot 22-75. Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. 5-0.
Thank you. Regarding our volunteer recognition program, the board established that in the rules of procedure to recognize different levels of service, years of service. We've been experimenting on presenting the award. The first time we did it, we had everyone come in right after the election. And some leave mid-year, so it's awkward, you know, when do you invite these people in? It's, last week we experimented. How did that go, Phil?
It went well.
Okay.
It went well. You know, it was a little bit of a surprise for a person, especially the first time that it was ever done.
Mm-hmm.
But...
Because that's one way we can do it when they're not, like in this case, we knew this person wasn't seeking office again.
Exactly.
So that was his last meeting. So Phil presented a pin to Tim Redman at the planning board meeting.
As chairman.
Right.
Yes, as chairman.
So.
That, I would feel that would be honoring a person among his peers that he has served with. And it could be this board's representative to that committee or if a backup, the chairman.
Mm-hmm.
And I do want to say Tim asked me to give the board his thank you for the pin. He appreciated it. So.
Yeah, I would agree. I think it's a much more personal touch if the board representative goes to the committee as opposed to asking them to come to us.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Our participation wasn't that great last time. Right, it was awkward.
Yeah.
I mean, we'll probably still have to do that.
How many do you envision?
For others that we don't know that are not coming back or we don't know ahead of time.
How many do we envision doing this
How
for
many?
In a year, do you think?
I don't know. Last time we invited like 15 and, a few showed up last year when we started.
We have different, our process is that if you've served for X amount of,
mm-hmm.
right, okay.
Yeah, there's a letter, there's a certificate, pin,
gotcha.
And plaque.
Right.
Okay, then we'll proceed.
Some
on
people
that.
Receive recognition at town meetings.
That's right.
Yeah.
Social media.
Did it help the turnout of the town meeting? I don't know.
No. But it is on my wall, though. Thank you.
Okay. The Penarva Community Planning Committee would like to open a Facebook page to interact with the community regarding Penardville's future. Brian Rose will be the primary monitor of the Facebook page, and Derek will be secondary when Brian's out of the office. The Facebook page will be open until March 2014 town meeting, because as he explains to me, there's going to be like different pieces for people to comment on as they move along in the process.
Yeah, this makes a whole lot of sense to me.
It does.
Yep.
I think it's a good way to try something.
Test it out, too. Yeah.
And I'd make a motion to authorize a waiver to the social media policy for this purpose.
And I'll second it.
Those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Thank you. And that's all I have.
Aye. 5-0. Thank you, Sue. and it brings us back to old business.
Which we've done.
Well.
Oh, I had some other old business.
See, I was waiting.
Yeah. I just want to let the board know that I contacted Sue because Selectman Pierce and I did a taped a television show on the budget, but it wasn't aired on GTV. And with only a week, or it was less than 2 weeks to go, I didn't see it in the program schedule. So I did reach out to Sue, who then contacted the folks over at GTV, and it is now running, mm-hmm. I think, twice a day or more.
Once a day when it's at night,
yeah,
when there's no live meeting.
Right. And then sometimes it's like twice or something. Yeah. So
I woke up one morning at 5 o'clock, turned it on, and watched the whole 40 minutes.
Good. So thank you, Sue.
Okay.
No, I had no comment.
Sorry to hear that, Dave, by the way. I had to wake up at 4 o'clock. To, well, I'm retired, so it was very unusual. Okay. Now, new business. This is our next to last session. Anything new, or just keep it quiet for two more sessions? Thank you, Scott. Why was I looking at you?
I don't know.
Committee reports, please. Historic District.
Historic District met last week, and we accepted the resignation of Elizabeth DeBrule as a member and chairman, and Ruth Gage was elected chairman.
So we'll have we'll invite Elizabeth back for her pin, because she's been on there.
6 years,
right?
Years,
right?
6, 7 years.
Yeah.
Thank you, Phil. Did the Conservation have anything?
Yeah, the Conservation Commission met last week. Had a discussion with Scott Bartlett, the town assessor, relative to walking conservation properties with a forester by the name of Newt. And the commission thought it was wise to go forward with that. We also had a discussion on some of the plans are up for review. By the planning board. One was the North Garden Restaurant. We discussed this at last week's meeting. Commission had no issues or concerns, but wanted to make sure the stormwater is managed and treated properly before being introduced into the town's drainage system. They also discussed a two-lot subdivision. This is one for the auto zone. And again, they had no issues or concerns. But wanted to make sure the landscaping was appropriate and a maintenance plan for the landscaping was in place. And finally, they discussed a proposal to consolidate and resubdivide two lots into three lots. This is in the Violet Street and Wilkins Street area of Pernardville. They had no issues of concern with that proposal as well. And that was it.
Yeah, good question.
Yes, Phil, got a question.
On the discussion about of North Garden, because in here what I have doesn't say who was there or not, was Megan Therio town engineer there?
No.
Okay. Just for your information, when we had the presentation, Megan was there, and the engineer for North Garden discussed that discharge area that they had, and they're going to work, and they didn't see that there would be any problems dealing with that
oh,
specific
good.
Issue.
Good.
So that should be all addressed when they come back to the planning board.
Great, thank you.
Committee reports, wrap it up with planning board.
Planning board did meet, and there was one item on the agenda besides presenting Tim Redmond his 8-year pen, which he did receive, and we had a one-item meeting, which was the determining whether the Miller's Landing was vested, and the board did reach an understanding that that particular project was, and there was a discussion with the representative for the owner, which was Elmer Pease. And Robert Howard, they agreed to some additional things that the planning board wanted to make sure that were done. and he had no issues with that, and he agreed right there at the meeting. And that agreement is going to be the type of agreement that was going to be worked up, and it was going to be a recordable agreement, because you can't amend the site plan, but this was going to be a recordable agreement that would go with the plans, so that if the project did get sold to somebody else and develop it, that goes with the project. So, and he agreed.
We have a meeting next week, which is the night before the elections.
So the board has constituted in its present format, has one more meeting left.
I had one more thing on the planning board, that there was a presentation for Southern New Hampshire Planning by Julie Chin. She made a short presentation regarding the 10-year plan, and noted deadline for submitting any requests was March 8th for the 10-year plan. And one of the things that was mentioned was possibly Public Works with the North Mass Road drainage issue, but we had no, because the deadline is March 8th.
Yeah, that's the one Carl mentioned earlier in the meeting, that he and Brian have been working on a letter to submit.
I apologize for not thinking about it earlier while Carl was here, but March 8th.
It's flexible deadline, I think.
Well,
Sue.
If something comes up, we could always have an emergency meeting.
Back to what you were starting to mention, I would hope this board doesn't meet for 4 hours the night before the election.
No, it'll be a very short business meeting.
The agenda will be a short business.
No appointments.
But perhaps we should resolve which selectmen will be present at which polling places.
That's right. And I don't think you can.
No,
because
you
are.
Well, he can, but he shouldn't.
I don't.
No, because you, in your official capacity, performing your official capacity, but I don't recommend it.
And we're going to have a lot of write-ins to deal with because of open spots.
Well, and I'll discuss the write-ins after, if you'd like. I've talked to the powers to be upstairs.
Mickey Mouse will not be counted.
Oh, Mickey Mouse will be counted. Oh.
Yes. And Donald Duck.
Donald Duck. What, and what Kathy intends to do is a book. A, B, C, D, all the way down to the end.
Let me mention, there are some vacancies where the slate does not fall.
Correct.
On the warrant.
Yep.
And so it's more than just possible. It's going to happen.
It's gonna
that
happen.
There'll be
multiple
names written in.
Yes, it'll be a long night.
Yeah. So you're about to explain something that the town clerk has a procedure for how to keep track of the write-ins.
What Kathy plans to do is she's going to give each group that has a write-in, trustee of trustees is where there's write-ins, there's three or four different write-ins. Going to get a book, going to be all alphabeticalized, A to Z, and as the write-ins come in, we're going to go through the ballots, we're going to flip and write them down in that book, and then go back and be counted. It's going to be a very labor-intense night. It's one of the only ways that we can get it done. Unfortunately, Mickey Mouse, Donald Duck, Boo Boo, and all the votes need to be counted.
So the you mentioned a group, but one or several people will say, I'm going to look at every ballot.
Correct.
And she's fill out this notebook as to the names of the.
Correct. You're going to stack them up in groups of 50 or 25, like it was done the last time.
And then
Move them along
from one group to the other.
One group will count one specific ballot for one vacancy write-in, and the other one will count another.
Makes sense. Yeah. Actually, Michael Quirk.
Yeah. Going to be there?
Huh?
Are you going to be there?
Oh, yeah.
So, which facility would like, which board member
I'll do the
wants
high school,
to open
I'll
up?
Start it, because you got to work, so I know.
I'll do the high school as well. I'll be show up later. But
okay.
Open the high school. Who's going to
open
Bartlett?
He'll open. I'll show up later.
Mr. Bartlett over
here.
Yeah,
Mr. Bartlett. Yep.
Then I'll show up at Bartlett.
Yep.
And what time are you going to get to the high school, Colin?
Mid-afternoon. Depends on my work day.
No, I was just wondering, because maybe I'll hit the high school for a while and then go to Bartlett.
Yeah, I want to say 3 o'clock, probably.
Well,
whenever, Phil. No problems. I just got
to
go.
I need like a pizza market break, you know, maybe around 11:30 to 2.
I'll
it's quite a break.
Oh, yeah.
I'll show up around 9 o'clock to make sure you've all properly done your jobs. Maybe I'll be interested in something else, too.
Okay. Just want to say one thing. I think, you know, staff did a really nice job on this annual report. Mm-hmm. And, you know, with the exception of seeing Carrie's face on the back, no, I'm like, I love Carrie. It's just a really good job. And I know it takes a lot of effort to put this thing together, and hopefully we'll win an award. And yeah. The other thing I want to let you know is that I received a lot of compliments on the voter's guide.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Great.
For, you know, that it was very clear, that I liked all the, you know, the graphs, so.
I had one inquiry today that they thought that the circle around the intersection over here on High and Elm and Main Street was a roundabout.
Who knows?
I said, well, that depends on the public input, but so, it's the preliminary design.
So the for the public, the voter's guide, which is a newspaper format that was mailed to all the residents.
And I'm happy to report
this last week
that due to Catherine's efforts, we discovered that the section of town on the other side of the river in Riverview Park, those 42 residents have never received this. And they did this year through her efforts.
Oh, that's great. Thank you, Catherine.
Good job.
Thank you
and Karen helped out, too, in town
clerk. Yeah, Karen told us that she never
bringing
received.
That's bringing back hard memories about zip code 03102.
Yes. Oh, please.
Yes, there was some linkage about that.
And we have also mentioned the town report for 2012, and these are hard copies are typically available when people come out of the polls.
I must say, too, what a difference it was publishing this annual report than previous years. We've done this in Word doc before. This year we had InDesign program, which we had purchased because the consultant on the Panardville Community Planning Group uses InDesign. And so we'd purchased the program at the end of last year, and it made it so much smoother. I mean, things didn't rearrange on their own every time you open the document.
So, thank you for the commercial plug.
Good tools make good work.
Closing comments here.
Tools make a difference. They do. When you have
recap in the evening, 74 Fairview Street, the Spagna residence. Mm-hmm. Do we need to address anything else on that, or are we pretty much set?
We have to go forward with the ordinance change.
Okay. All right, so that
before we can address it.
But we're giving an emergency.
Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
I just want to make sure.
Yeah.
It's starting tomorrow, as I understand.
Yeah. It's starting tomorrow. Yes.
Well, one of the questions that I had, I mean, as a health issue, is that something that could be done through a health officer?
Well, the health officer would require the work to be done, but. That's already going on.
Yeah, okay, but I didn't know if there was some statutory ability of something due to health that could preclude the difficulty we have at hand for doing any waivers. Would that be a different type of a super?
No, because the waiver that they're looking for is for the cost of repaving, right. Basically.
It, at that point, instead of repaving just where the opening is in the road, it's repaving for
100 feet?
50 feet either side.
50 yeah. feet on either side. And
curb to curb.
So that the paving side is feathered down over. Yep. A longer period.
And that's the huge cost, and that's what they're looking for relief on.
And the temporary has to remain in place for at least a year, and I mean, it's a whole bunch of other.
Yeah, and unfortunately, I know of one situation where a home owner was facing this substantial cost, and the house had to be sold, so they footed the bill for the opening of the road and feathering of the patch over 100 feet.
Yeah.
It was not something the homeowner desired to do because it is considerably more expensive.
But it has been done in the past, and that was
something that the homeowner did just within the past year.
Yeah. Did you want to do your non-public callers in real estate tonight?
Yes, oh yeah, for sure. So we have no second public comment, so should I assume?
Are we all done with public?
Okay, so I'm prepared to make a motion to go into a non-public session under RSA 91A, 3, Roman 2D, land and real estate.
Second.
Have a roll call on that.
Yes,
Mark,
sir.
Call
yes.
us. Yes, here?
Yes.
Phil?
Yes. Yes.
We'll go into non-public now, and that
GTV
will be...
GTV can conclude?
GTV can conclude.